Okay, issue four, Trump's new order.
Together we will defend our sovereignty, security, and protect a free and open Indo-Pacific region for our children and for many, many generations to come.
Addressing more than 100,000 citizens of the world's most populous democracy, President Trump this week sought to advance a new strategic partnership. India, Trump and many U.S. officials hope, will serve as a superpower linchpin against a rising China. But while India, with its nearly 1.4 billion citizens and rapidly growing economy, now the world's fifth largest, once close to U.S. relations, it remains reluctant to endorse an alliance against China.
John, do you anticipate India ever becoming an ally a la Australia or Japan or the United Kingdom? And secondly, if you want, on the follow-up to your answer, you can give us your opinion on what's happening in Turkey and Syria at the moment.
Yeah, India is not going to become an Australia or Japan, you know, level of ally of the United States. But it is becoming an important strategic partner because we have similar threat perceptions, meaning that we are on roughly the same page about China and also radical Islam and terrorism. And of course, India being the world's largest democracy, this is sort of a good narrative for the White House and for the U.S. government. And of course, we've already seen this shift. U.S. Pacific Command was recently renamed Indo-Pacific Command to show that we are taking a comprehensive look at all this. We are developing a serious security relationship with India that has not existed before. During the Cold War, of course, India was rather closely tied with Moscow. But there are challenges here, one of which is that India does see itself as a regional hegemon, fairly so. They remind us regularly it is the Indian Ocean. And the U.S. doesn't really like bilateral relationships with equal partners. It's really not, to be frank, that's not how this usually works. And India expects to be treated as an equal. And that is a learning process for the Pentagon and the U.S. government, I think especially for this administration. For all their commonalities with the Modi government on many issues, there are sort of hardwired obstacles that need to be overcome on our side.
And on Turkey, then?
Well, we're in a very dangerous position where the Erdogan government has upped the ante in Syria, and they've been hit back rather hard by the Russians around Idlib, and 30 or so Turkish troops have been killed. We're in a dangerous moment. I think things will de-escalate, but the burgeoning partnership between Ankara and Moscow is looking very dodgy right now.
Pat?
On India, the United States is not going to give a war guarantee to India that we're going to come to their defense. For example, if they get in a war over the Chinese-occupied parts of India, Aksai Chin, parts in the east. So that's not going to happen, and they should be a partner and a friend. With regard to Syria.
Should they be a trading partner?
Oh, certainly.
Oh, you like that, do you?
I mean,
you normally don't like trade.
No, look, I don't like trade. Just put tariffs on the stuff coming in.
All right. Sorry. Okay.
No, let's go to Syria. That is the most horrible situation in the world today, I think. Look what happened. We partly started that by supporting under the Arab Spring the rebels in northwest Syria. They got beat by Al-Qaeda and ISIS. Then we're in there fighting Al-Qaeda and ISIS. As for the Turks, look, we're going to have to tell the Turks, you're our NATO ally, but you are in another country. You're not in, we don't agree with what you're doing. We're not sending troops into Syria.
What about Patriot batteries to the border? That's what they want.
Well,
missile batteries.
Well, I think, didn't they buy some Russian anti-aircraft?
Yeah, they did indeed.
S-400s, get them from Putin.
I think we should mention the president has just visited India in what seemed to be a very successful trip. Jimmy Kimmel described it as the Eat, Pray, Love Myself tour, which I thought was rather appropriate.
Well said.
And it happened against the backdrop of rioting and some pretty brutal crackdowns, and that came out of this law that the Modi government has passed, a citizenship law, which seems to make Muslims second-class citizens. And so I think, you know, the president and Modi have a lot in common. They're both kind of authoritarian figures. They like these Muslim bans. So I think there's a meeting of minds, and you know, it's the largest democracy in the world, but they have not done much to try to curb climate change. There are a lot of difficulties, and I think President Trump is basically an enabler in a lot of the negative things that I would see about India
China
today.
China hasn't done much on climate change either.
Oh,
they
yes,
say
they
have, but they're putting all these coal plants online.
They're engaged in the process here. They say
coal plants.
They say you're already ahead in the race, and we're still trying to catch up. But no, that's a problem. That's been an ongoing problem. It's got to be solved through negotiations. Problem with Modi. He is just such a flagrant violator of human rights. It is appalling, and to make Muslims second-class citizens, for example. I noticed he had a lovely ceremony, a welcoming ceremony for Donald Trump, which always wins Donald Trump's heart. But maybe he's going to ignore those domestic issues, but they cannot stand forever. And I think that's going to be a looming problem.
And it is interesting, John, that you see with Modi this effort, on the one hand, to build these links with the world, right. And the other hand, with a political base that is split between that sort of modernity and ultra-nationalist, Hindu ultra-nationalism, will really despise Muslims.
Yeah, right. I mean, look, the BJP, what they are is a Hindu nationalist party. They're very open about this. They are not particularly fond of India's enormous Muslim minority. And, this is a big problem when you are the world's biggest democracy. And the BJP's been rising for years. And with Modi, they now have their sort of hero, Trump-like hero figure.
Let's also mention Gandhi and Nehru were the originators of that.
BJP does not like them one bit.
Across religious lines. Yeah, this is a big step back. And truly tragic.
But this is, we were talking about this earlier, the rise of ethno-nationalism,
absolutely.
The rise of religious fundamentalism. You may decry it, but it is really happening. Look, the Hindus are 1 billion of them in India. They outnumber the Muslims 200 by 4-1 there. You got the problem in Kashmir that still exists up there. So I think what the United States should do militarily is stay out of the problems of India, external and internal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but how does the world stand by while this humanitarian crisis is unfolding in Syria, where you have reports of children literally freezing to death
what
in these
we
camps?
Do?
We should mobilize humanitarian aid. I'm not talking about military intervention.
How?
I would like to see the United Nations get involved. I would like to see the white helmeted people go in.
Well, the Russians bomb them. That's
standing by and doing nothing, it just seems to me unacceptable world.
We've always got economic pressures as well. Our trade has been growing with them. Them being the world's largest English speaking country, they got the call center industry cornered.
You're jumping back to India, right?
Right. There's a lot we could be doing to show our humanitarian stand.
We do not want to accept that the Assad regime with Russian help has won the Syrian civil war. The embers will burn on for years. There will be parts of Syria they will not get back probably for a generation, if ever. But the civil war is functionally over.
Well, I think the Kurds are going to have to give up that part of eastern Syria they control now. Well, when the Americans pull out, if the Kurds are smart, they'll go to Damascus, cut a deal, give us a measure of autonomy in term for return to the land. It's over.
Well,
John's right.
The tribes in Deir ez-Zor in the east and the Kurds still have some areas because of the American guarantee there. And the Russians have been trying to mess with our troops.
Well,
push them off the road.
We got
that video, Pat?
We've taken the oil, I know.
Yeah.
But we're not going to hold the oil. The Syrians are going to get it back.
I like to think we might hold it. But, but here's an issue with Idlib, right? The Russian campaign there, the challenge, Elizabeth Warren articulated this, we need humanitarian aid. The problem is the Russians control the airspace.
Right.
And the Russians are deliberately bombing hospitals and schools to kill civilians.
There were consequences to Obama walking away from his own red line in September 2013, and that's where this all goes back to. No, I'm sorry,
Back to Obama.
It does.
I think the current president is quite palsy-walsy with both Erdogan and Putin. So why didn't he or his Secretary of State or somebody get in there
to stop killing civilians? How?
That's for them to figure out,
This way. There's a lot of space between the palsy-walsy relation and war.
One at a time.
That we could be exerting and we're not.
U.S. Central Command does not have a palsy-walsy relationship with Moscow or the Kremlin, okay?
But
when you say, let's do something, you have to ask, you want to use the military instrument. What do you mean, and against whom?
We're going to
shoot down
Russian planes.
Right, you know good and well the relationship that our commander-in-chief has with their commander-in-chief.
All right,
Are you going to shoot down the Russian planes?
That's right.
No, we're not going to do that. You're going to put in American troops. If Trump started doing that, he would lose the election.
I think Putin on the world stage. And
how does that work?
He doesn't care. Yes.
Well,
I assure you he does not.
All right. One issue, Pat, that you could do prospectively is you look at Bashar al-Assad's economy is very weak because of the passage of what's called the Caesar Act, named after a photographer who took photos of his girl. Do you believe in that? Would you support that, putting the economic pressure on his regime?
On who? Erdogan?
No, Assad. To punish him for Idlib.
What kind of person? what kind of economic pressure you're going to put on him. He won the war. He wants his country back.
So you say no to the Caesar Act.
He's fought and bled and died for it. He's not going to give it up for aid from the United States.
Making him into a hero. He's fought and bled and died for his country. I don't see that civil war in the same way.
We need to exert any economic and political pressure we can on the Assad regime to behave better. But we need to be very realistic about what our military and political options are here. If making Putin look bad really was an option, they would not have taken Crimea.
No.
They would not keep doing what they're doing in Chechnya.
No.
Come on.
Get him to stop killing civilians. Show the pictures of the children.
Let's go to Clarence.
One of the big mistakes, John, as you may remember, that we made in Syria was presuming Assad was going to yield to being invaded. And we weren't willing to go farther than that.
Why should we go further than that? Because we should go into Syria and decide who runs that place.
Well, the argument has to be made.
I'm not a big fan of regime change either, Pat.
We've gotten into more troubles than there are things we can do, though.
One argument would be, though, Pat, that the Assad regime, because of the deliberate sectarian nature of targeting Syrian Sunnis, has empowered ISIS, right? That in the long game, exerting pressure on Assad allows you to remove the grievance factor.
The people that empowered ISIS are the people that started the civil war and then lost it. That includes us. ISIS came in to replace the so-called good rebels. Then they took over and produced their caliphate. Then we had to go in and destroy that. Now we've wound up with the eastern part of Syria, and we can't hold it. We should never have gone in.
All right.
I don't think we really did go in.
We aided rebels to overthrow the government.
The roots of ISIS, correct me if I'm wrong, but when we invaded and took over Iraq, and then just put all the civil servants out of business.
All right.
That was the beginning of ISIS.
Correct. All right.